Okay, this is coming from CBS News. And shout out to Julius Garcia, my ace, one of my aces in my think tank. U.S. reaches 100,000 coronavirus hospitalizations. People who follow the infection rate, that's what's actually most proposed. I actually follow more the death rates and hospitalization, because infection rates means that you've been exposed to it, you caught it, you could have fought it off, you could have not even known that you had it, but the thing is, it's going to be there. And the reason they do that, even though they don't tell you, is basically they're tracking the spread to see how fast this pathogen spreads, which is why they really test. They're not testing to see if you're sick, they're testing to see how fast the disease spreads. And unfortunately, they pushed that number out a little bit more forcefully than the deaths. Because the deaths can be 1,000 people dying a day, 2,000 people dying a day. People go, yeah, it's like, you know, you see 250,000 people die. People say, okay, well, you know, people die like that from cancer. And so they blow it off. But the bigger number about the disease spread, which is a bigger number, attracts more attention, which is why the news outlets use it, even though I really don't pay that much attention to the number of people that have it. I pay attention to how many people get sick from it and have to be hospitalized for it, and how many people actually die from it. That's what I usually follow more concerned with. The United States on Wednesday surpassed 100,000 coronavirus hospitalizations, a record high since the beginning of the pandemic, according to the COVID Tracking Project. Hospitalizations have more than tripled nationwide since October 1st, leaving healthcare systems stretched thin as facilities begin to run out of room for new patients. South Dakota, Nevada, Indiana lead the nation in hospitalizations per capita, while California has the highest number with 9,365 hospitalizations, according to the COVID Tracking Project. Gavin Newsom said California's hospital system cannot sustain patients at its current rate of 75% ICU capacity. If current rates stay steady or increase, California will run out of ICU beds before December 25th. I fear hospitals in South Dakota, Indiana, and Nevada are already facing. That's what I heard. In Reno, the renowned regional medical center is already caring for 30 patients at the hospital's alternate care site, a parking garage. Since the onset of the pandemic, renowned staff have treated over 219 patients at the alternate care site. Sounds a lot like New York. According to the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, the overall weekly hospitalization rate is at its highest point in the pandemic, with additional steep increases in individuals aged 65 years and older. With the current number of hospitalized COVID-19 patients, there are 66% more people currently hospitalized than there were during the first peak in April, when large cities around the country began to run out of hospital beds. Some states are also grappling with how to staff hospitals. More than 1,000 hospitals across the country are experiencing critical staffing shortages, according to the Department of Human Health and Services. The reality is, December, January, and February are going to be rough times. I actually believe they're going to be in the most difficult time in public health history of this nation, largely because of the stress it's going to put on our healthcare system, Dr. Robert Redfield said Wednesday during a U.S. Chamber of Commerce event. I do think, unfortunately, before we see February, we could be close to 450,000 Americans dead from the virus, Redfield said, while urging Americans to continue mitigation efforts such as social distancing, wearing masks, limiting crowds, and not let their guards down during family gatherings. Britain on Wednesday became the first country to approve Pfizer's COVID-19 vaccine. The U.S. is expected to follow suit in the upcoming weeks. If Pfizer and Moderna's incorporated vaccines are given emergency approval by the Food and Drug Safety Administration, federal officials overseeing the distribution said the first vaccine could be available in the U.S. as early as December 15th. Two things. First of all, and I'm going to get blowback, but yes, this is real. Okay. Yes, that they're desperate. And yes, I've heard on the low that they are hiding bodies. They've been hiding bodies and sicknesses since the beginning. That's evident. Texas, Florida, Georgia, a bunch of states actually do that. They'll hide the stats and keep them on hold, and then once they get the test back and they have to release it, they'll release them all at once. So you'll get a day in Texas. I've seen this a few times in Texas where the numbers will be low and all of a sudden they'll add like 2,000 or 1,000 people that are dead to the list in one day. And you know that there's no way 1,500 people or 2,000 people could have died of COVID-19 on one day. Okay, they just put them on the list and just do a dump. And the reason that the initial lockdowns happened in the first place is because they wanted to limit, slow the spread. They know everybody's going to get it. That's what's going to happen. But what they wanted to do is slow the spread so that the hospitals and the healthcare system could actually handle it. So you wouldn't have a lot of people dead. Because if they hadn't done that, you'd have seen a hell of a lot more people dead. If they had let this stuff run wild before they knew what they had or how to handle it, you'd have seen a hell of a lot more people dead. It would have been at least double the number. You'd have had like a million people dead in a year rather than 400,000, maybe even more. Because now they worked with it. They know how to handle it. They know how to treat it. So you don't have a bunch of death pits like they have in El Paso or like they had in New York. When they were sending those patients off to a convalescence home, they were sending them there to die because they couldn't treat them. That's the honest truth. That's what New York was doing. They were sending those people to those convalescence homes to die, just like they did in, what they're doing in El Paso. And from what I'm hearing is that a number of deaths in El Paso that are not being reported could be double. There could be double the amount of people dead in Texas than they're reporting. Just like New York was covering up a bunch of their dead by burying those people in those fields before they're being tested. I know at least the death rate was at least 25% higher in New York than they actually reported. And I'm sure the same thing could be said of Texas, maybe even California, because if you're homeless, you're not, and nobody cares, they're not going to do any autopsy on you. They're not going to check you for coronavirus. It's going to put you in a hole and leave you forgotten. With that being said, Coach Greg Adams actually said something that was true, and I agreed with him. And when he said something about the vaccine, they're not going to force you to take it. They're not going to make you take it. They're not going to kick down your doors and drag you out, shoot you in the arm. They're not going to do that. And they won't have to do it. People in Americans are so spoiled that they're so willing to get back to normal, go back to work, go back outside, go back to their regular life, that if they offer the vaccine, it doesn't matter whether it's thoroughly tested or not. It doesn't even matter whether it's a placebo. And it's probably better that it's a placebo. They just need something to put you on record to stamp you as safe, to shoot your children up with something to send them back to school, get you back to work to save their precious economy. So they won't have to keep spending $2-4 trillion every 3 months or every 6 months to keep you alive or keep you going. They want you to go back to work. They want you to contribute to the economy, not drain it. So just like Great Britain, to save their economy, they're willing to fast track this vaccine. And I would guarantee you like 80-90% of the people will take it. They will take the vaccine because they want to get back to their normal life. People are so desperate to get outside. They were willing to riot. They're willing to burn down the whole country just to go to a party, go to a bar. So hell yeah, if it means that you can get back to normal, you can travel, you can get back on a plane, you can go back to work, you can go back to your normal life, you will take that vaccine and you'll do it happily. As soon as the first responders and the essential people like teachers and police officers and whatnot take the vaccine and not too many of them fall over dead, you'll get in line, you'll take the shot just so they can put you on record. You'll be able to actually put it on your phone as a contact tracing so you can get back to normal. You will do that and you will do it happily. And to say that you won't is bullshit. Because as soon as you can't go to a bar, can't participate in school, or can't make a living, you'll take that risk. Everybody knows that the goddamn vaccine is not 95% effective because it hasn't even been tested. All it means is 95% of the people or whatever it is didn't have any side effects. They have no idea how effective this vaccine is going to be until they put it out in the wild. To say that it will keep you from getting coronavirus is bullshit. You're going to get it. You'll probably get it just like everybody else gets the flu every year because the damn thing mutates. There's no way they can actually give you a vaccine for something that mutates as fast as this does. But the thing is, they're going to sell it. You're going to take it because you need to get back to normal. And eventually I'll take it too because I want to get back to normal. But guess what? I'm going to let y'all test it out first. That's what I'm going to do. I'm going to wait. I'm gonna wait and see how many bodies hit the floor before I test it. And unfortunately, my grandson probably will have to take it too, even though we're gonna delay it as long as possible. I hate when he takes vaccine shots because his body is sensitive. And right now, I don't think I'm willing to risk his health just so he can go get back in class and everybody can go get back to normal. I'd rather teach him myself. If push comes to shove, and this is the way that they're gonna send kids back to school, I'd rather take him and teach him myself, even though he'll actually hate it. He probably would rather the vaccine so he can go back to school and play with his friends. But in the end, this is their solution. Even the Fed chairman actually said something that was telling that probably nobody else picked up. He said, taking a vaccine is not gonna get you out of this economic crisis. The vaccine alone will not save you, which is telling it would, because I think that's what our high officials, our leaders, our managers are banking on. Give them a vaccine, put them back to work. January 1st, when it's time for people to get put out of their apartments and evicted from their places, they're gonna say, we'll hold this up if you go back to work. We'll put an abeyance on you getting put out of your apartment, out of your house, out of your homes, if you go back to work. But to go back to work, you gotta take this vaccine. Guess what you're gonna do? January 1st, you will be taking a vaccine. They're already doing it in the UK. So the sum of all your fears are gonna happen. The only thing that you're wrong about is they're not gonna make money off of this. They don't care. They're willing to give you the shot for free. They really are. Congress will spend a couple of billion dollars distributing this vaccine. They will. Because if not, it's gonna cost them $2 trillion to actually keep you alive. Guess what they're gonna do? They're gonna opt for the cheaper version of it. It's not rocket science, folks. If you follow the bouncing ball, you can see the direction of where things are gonna go. It's not tea leaves or reading the crystal ball. It's just reading the playbook. That's all it is. They only have a few options. And basically their options are up. It's either pay a whole bunch of money to keep you at home or give you this shot and send you back to work. So just like the meat packers were sent back to work, so will you. At the end of the day, you're nothing but a brick in a wall. All this independence and this individualism that you claim to have, this freedom that you claim to have, this independence that you claim to have, you're starting to realize what the system is built on and how it's put together and what happens when the bricks start to fall off. It doesn't work. So they're gonna use this vaccine as a little cement. They're gonna place you back into your place and gonna rebuild the wall. And you're gonna be happy about it. Anyway, that's all I got. This is BGS out, and I'll see you guys on the next one. Peace.